metadata, not data. Two different types, occurrence and taxonomy. How do we publish the data? All right, we're going to start with the occurrence data. So, you can see it's composed of two parts, the resource metadata and the actual data itself. Now this morning, you saw from Laura how to upload source data and how to make source mappings. And it's been mentioned how to make your data private or public, and I've even demonstrated how to register it. So, we did the metadata. You guys all know that, right? That's the basic metadata page. The source data, you guys have all seen that. That's your uploaded data. You can visualize its format, the limiter, size, rows. Right? Then there was the mappings. Right? So here you can see that we have one mapping that was done to the occurrence core, which means this is occurrence data, like a specimen or observation. And then Laura went through a series of mappings with you. Okay? So this is all on the road of publishing data. So you've already seen part of it already. Don't be confused. It's all part of the process. There's a way to exclude certain rows in your data. So it's, you could think of it as a way of filtering or cleaning your data. You can play around with that. There's a way to choose from a list of standard names for a given field. The example given here is the type. And in that drop-down, there's a whole bunch of different selections, but you're basically constrained by this list of selections. And the same applies to the basis of record in other fields, where it just makes sense to choose from a small list, like a predefined list of options. Sex is another option. You're going to see it for this. Then there's a translation feature. So, just like in our Google Refine example, when we have a whole bunch of rows and sometimes, for example, with country, we've entered USA, sometimes we've entered United States, US, U.S. U.S. A. You want to do a translation. So you want to say, okay, in my data it said USA, but actually the translated value that I'd like to choose is United States. And if you save that, it doesn't modify your original data set inside Google Refine or Excel. But what it does is that when you're publishing the data, all values that say USA are going to be automatically converted into the United States. So it's a way of cleaning your data during the publishing phase. It's recommended that you go back to the original source data and make those changes there. But this is another option. Again, I would recommend you change the original source data, but if that's not possible, then you can always do it. So, the visibility, the default is private, so nobody can see your data set. You change that to public, the world can all of a sudden see it. Then there is the publish button. Okay? So, publish, it does a lot of things. Okay? And we've had people complain that it's not the greatest name for this button, but if we described everything that happens, it would be a very big button and probably wouldn't fit in the bench. So what this publish button does is it publishes your metadata, and it publishes your, in this case, occurrence data. And it wraps everything into a DOM core. And so when you press that button, you'll actually see some log messages that describe what it is that happened behind the scenes. So, the first line, archive generation started with a resource. Started by the data file. The EML file, which is the metadata file, was there. The metadata XML file was written. That's the XML descriptive file that tells the mappings between your column names and all of your terms. Everything was compressed, and it says thumbs up. The dog archive was successfully generated. If there were problems during publication, you could see the thing. Now, once you've published, you might like to register. You might remember from the demonstration earlier that I registered a test resource against the Danish Biodiversity Information Facility, which in my demonstration is the data, the owner of my data set. And every time that you press the publish button, once it's already been registered, that's another thing that it's going to do. It's going to update your registration. So, that's a very brief overview of how to publish an occurrence data set. And there's actually a nice tutorial there that I think John wrote some time ago. And I invite you all to try that. But for today, we've got this workbook, and that's the exercise that we're going to be sticking with. So, the next part is taxonomic data. Same idea. You've got metadata, and you've got your taxonomic data. Now, quite often, when we talk about taxonomic data, we talk about checklists. And this is exactly like what I was talking about with that list of names in the national parks in Cameroon. It doesn't have to always contain geospatial data. It doesn't have to have coordinates. Sometimes it's just nice to know what exists where. Right? So, that is in essence a checklist. And that list of names can be constrained by a taxonomic group. So, all the lions in a particular place. Geographic region. So, especially the little part of Cameroon, I don't know. Themes, such as invasive species. Or all three. So there's actually a whole bunch of different checklist types. I'm not going to go into each of them in detail, but if you're interested, just ask for us afterwards, okay? For now, I think it's just enough to know that a checklist is a list of names, and there are different types of lists. So who uses checklists, and why would you want to publish them? Well, taxonomists use them. Kind of a lot of life uses them, so they aggregate checklists from different sources to build tree of life, let's call it. Protected area managers, they need to know what species are inside the protected area. Conservation organizations, policy makers, ecologists. So this is also valuable information. Okay? So the distinction between occurrence data, specimens, observations, and really just a list of names. They both sort of serve their purpose. And this is another thing that came up at lunch, is that Priscilla said, I had done some work on my master's, and I had compiled a list of names, but it didn't have any geospatial information. I had no coordinates, so how can I publish this? So Priscilla, the answer is that different names. Now, Priscilla's problem was also compounded by the fact that she lost her data because it was never published and it existed just on her computer, and her computer's hard drive failed or something like that, right, Priscilla? So, that's another good reason to publish your information so that it lives on, so that at least it can be indexed and the information can be backed up in a sense. So, where can we find checklists? Well, they are discoverable in the registry today. And in the next version of the GDIF data portal, due out this year, you're going to be able to discover the checklist there as well. So, the steps to basically create an occurrence data set and a checklist data set in the IPT are basically the same. The only difference comes with choosing the right core. But there's some extended features that I'll briefly talk about here, since it's a good opportunity. And similarly, you've got your metadata component. You've got a different set of channels than your occurrence call. And then you've got extensions. So this is the feature that I want to narrow in on right now, okay? So you've got a list of names. Maybe that's not that interesting. What else can you describe? Well, maybe in many of Cameron's languages, they have a name. They each have a name for that tree. So a vernacular name, a common name. So it would be nice to describe all the names of trees inside that protected area. And it would also be nice to know that all the local people call those trees in their own language, right? So you can add an extension for vernacular names. And I'll bring you back to this concept of publishing using many-to-one relations. So you've got one core record, which is your name in this case, and you've got multiple vernacular names. So this is the star schema, many-to-one schema, and it's a powerful publishing feature inside the IPT. And we do that using extensions. And you can see there's a list of different extensions. You've got species descriptions, distributions, references, type information. So all of a sudden, your list of names becomes extremely rich. Got links and identifiers, resource relationships. So there are some best practices to publishing checklists as well. We want to show the scientific names. We want the complete classification, if we can. We want to publish as many synonyms that we know about. And include as much metadata and the citations and attributions. So, the different sources of the names. A bunch of different resources here. Okay. Those are great resources authored by some GDIF staff and externals. They're very well written.